question two.
Start korbo paro.
My login hoisilo. Just a minute, huh?
Boy, bro, I want to form a chart.
My just humai silo. Just aru olay hai bolga hol. Ek minute, huh? My just login ko uswaro
ba. Hi. Apuni ap.
So can you start the program, sir?
Lokhini roba ei ticketor kam kin hoilo imon resource person
mas
sare mute ache
hopefully ma khomabo parisu sage
hoy apuni apunar sharing to hoisene silo apunar to clear korilo sir
sharing to silo no
hoy Principal sir.
Start for this. A very good morning, respected president sir, respected principal sir, today's resource person, teachers, dear participants, my colleagues, and dear students. Myself, Dr. Lakshminath, Assistant Professor, Department of Economics, Dimoria College. Today we are here to organize the national webinar on social and economic implications of the digital divide. So the first agenda of today's program is welcome speech by our honorable principal sir. So I would like to request Dr. Biman Kumar Bhatta sir to deliver the welcome speech. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Lakshmi. Good morning, everybody present in this virtual meeting platform. At the outset, I welcome honorable president of governing body, Dimoria College, Professor K.G. Bhattacharjee sir, to this webinar. We have invited sir to inaugurate this webinar on social and economic implications of digital divide. Next, I would like to welcome the resource person of today's webinar, Dr. Hemanta Barman, Assistant Professor of Economics, Cotton University. Welcome you, sir. Hope that your deliberations will enrich the academic community present here. I also welcome the guest participant, teacher friends, the research scholars, and their students, without whose presence this webinar would not have been possible to organize. to this web meeting. Lastly, I welcome all the teacher and student participants from the De Moria College fraternity to this webinar, who joined with a desire to enrich themselves with the latest development of digital inequality and its impact on the society in the long run. Wishing a grand success of this national webinar organized by the PG Department of Economics in collaboration with IQSC De Moria College, and welcoming all the participants once again, I conclude. Thank you. Over to Lakshmi.
Thank you so much, sir. Our next agenda is inaugural speech by the president of governing body, De Moria College. So I would like to request Professor Krishna Gopal Bhattacharya, sir, to deliver the inaugural speech. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Lakshmi. Am I audible? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay.
Sir, you are audible, sir.
Okay. Principal of the college, Dr. Biman Bhatta, faculty of the Department of Economics and other departments of the college, guest present, and more particularly the today's speaker, Dr. Hemanta Barwan, assistant professor of Department of Economics, Cotton College. So today, I think I must congratulate IQSC De Moria College as well as the Economics Department for selecting a very important topic, particularly in the context of the present situation: social and economic implications of the digital divide. This is a very important topic. And we know that this COVID-19 pandemic, starting from the last November, December of 2019, has created a situation in the whole of the world which is unprecedented, and all unprecedented in all aspects, in its scale, et cetera, in its coverage, et cetera. And we also know that all the sectors of our life are affected, but one of the sectors which is much more affected than any other sector probably is the education. The COVID-19 pandemic has created the largest disruption of education system in the history of the world. And never has such disruption take place. And according to UNESCO, the students affected, the number of students affected is more than 1.6 billion, huge number, and the students are from more than one. This is not just our country which is affected, but all the countries of the world are affected. The globe as a whole is affected. And we also know that the closure of schools, colleges, universities, and other institutions have impacted 94% of the world's student population. It's a huge number, 94%. And if we consider the low and lower middle income countries, the affected students number 99%. That means almost all the students are affected. Now, we had, even before the COVID, we had disparities in the education system, particularly in the developing and the underdeveloped countries. Lots of disparities were there. And but these have increased several folds due to the COVID pandemic. And the opportunities for the opportunities are decreasing rapidly for the vulnerable children, youth, and adults. Living in the poor and rural areas, girls, refugees, persons with disabilities, displaced persons, etc. Their problems have multiplied many times because of this pandemic. And learning losses due to the COVID pandemic, starting with the end 2019, as I have told you before, threaten to extend beyond the present generation. That means these losses will cross over the present generation and may fall over into the several generations coming. And it will erase decades of progress, educational access and retention, most particularly for the girls and young women. So everybody says that girls and young women will be affected much more by the disruption in our education system than probably boys, because if parents can afford to send someone to the schools and colleges, they will prefer to send the boy rather than the girls. So girls will be much more affected by this thing. It has been shown that some 23.8 million children and youth of all ages are likely to drop out from the education system because of the pandemic. That means the dropout rate will increase hugely because of the pandemic situation. Similarly, the education disruption has had and will continue to have substantial effects beyond education. Closure of educational institutions hampers the provision of essential services to children and communities. For example, the midday meal scheme. It is now no longer there. It is not possible for the government to implement this. So the particularly the students coming from the lower income groups will not have access to nutritious food. And the ability of many parents to work, and because these children are at home, the parents also cannot go out for work. In any case, work facilities are not there. So economy is affected. I think this will be deliberated upon in this webinar. And another thing which has been pointed out by an organization like UNESCO, that because of the COVID pandemic, there are increased risk of violence against women and girls. Because everybody is at home, so, and along with the women and girls. So probably, and it has been actually suggested that there will be more violence against women during this pandemic period when everybody is at home. The financing of education could also face major challenges. Financing of education for countries like ours is already not up to the mark. But then because the government has to spend a lot of money in the health sector in meeting the challenges posed by the pandemic, money in the health sector, that the grants for education will come down after the post-COVID situation arises. And this crisis has, at the same time, stimulated some innovation within the education sector. We have seen innovative approaches in support of education and training continuity, from radio and television to broadband networks. Distance learning solutions have been proposed and these are being implemented. But one thing we have to remember, that most of the students do not have any training for this online education. Most of the teachers do not have any training in supporting this online education. But then this is the, somehow some people are adapting to these changes. These changes have also highlighted that the promising future of learning and the accelerated changes in modes of delivering quality education are related to the pandemic. And in fact, actually, although we have left behind many people from this new innovative approach to education, but then this is probably there to stay for a long time. That means we must have some kind of blended education system where many of the things will be taught online and some, maybe the physical contact will be less and less. So the COVID-19 crisis and the unparalleled education disruption is far from over. This is still continuing and we do not know when it will end. People think that if we can cover, say 100% of the people by vaccination, of course, in many cases, vaccination is not yet out, for example, in our country, for below 18 age students. But then even then people suggest that if we can cover by vaccination, most of the people, and also somehow if we can stop the mutation of the virus from one variety to another variety, from one variety to maybe a more dangerous variety, if we can stop that mutation, then probably we can have some control over the COVID pandemic. But when it happens, how long it takes is anybody's guess. So in fact, the schools and colleges are now closed in most of the countries, and as many as 100 countries in the world have not been able to take a decision on a date to open the schools and colleges and other institutions. And because they are very much afraid that once the schools and colleges are open, the virus will spread again in a huge way. So given the continued virulence of the virus, the majority of countries are yet to decide what to do. how to and they are most busy in managing their economies, but they are also, because the economy depends upon the education system, they are also very busy how to do something with the education system. And we know that an estimated 40% of the poorest countries fail to support learners at risk during the COVID-19 crisis. We are saying that some form of education is going on, even without examination, maybe the results are, we are announcing the results. But then the estimation is that 40% of the poorest countries have failed to support the students with this type of online education, et cetera, and other tools. And particularly, this is also particularly affecting the children with disabilities who have very little option to go. So their education is almost totally 100% affected. So now, coming to the today's this topic, digital divide, the social and economic implications of the digital divide. We have a very young economist, Hemanta Barman, will be speaking to us on this. I think he'll be able to discuss all the different aspects of the problem. But we already know that even before the COVID pandemic, digital divide was there, and it has now become a social phenomenon because the facilities are spread unequally from country to country and even within the country. So normally this digital divide refers to the separation between those who have access to digital information and communication technology, which we call as ICT technology, and those who do not. So this is the divide between those who have access to digital information and communication technology and those who do not have. So these ICTs have restructured the global economic and social equation. Knowledge has become the basic form of capital, and now knowledge is being spread through these ICT tools. But those who have do not access to ICT tools, what they will do is again a big problem. Now, effects of the digital divide are immensely felt in the areas of education, job opportunities, communication, politics, consumer satisfaction, health information, community involvement, government, and emergency information. So in all these sectors are very critically affected by the digital divide. The global digital divide describes global disparities, primarily between developed and developing countries in regard to access to and information resources, just as the internet and the opportunities derived from such access. So therefore, this OECD has given the original definition of digital divide. I think Dr. Barman will deliberate on this. So according to OECD, the gap between individuals, households, businesses, and geographic areas at different socioeconomic levels with regard both to their opportunities to access ICTs and to their use of the internet for a wide variety of activities. That is what is digital divide. In this respect, a few years back, the Nobel laureate, Amartya Sen, has said, internet is aggravating the digital divide between the literature and the literate. I quote him again. Professor Amartya Sen has said, I quote, internet is aggravating the digital divide between the literate and the illiterate. That is his definition. He said that the internet is a great tool, but it is increasing the digital divide between those who are literate and those who are illiterate. So internet's contribution is in making information more easily and more widely available. But on the other hand, it is hardening the divide that already exists between the illiterate and the literate. In a country like India, again, Professor Sen has said that in a country like India, we have a huge number of divisions, and the digital divide is adding one more division to that divide. He has said that in India, we have large number of differences between, say, the people of one state and the people of another state, people of one locality, people of another locality, rich, poor, so many divisions are there. But then internet has added to the number of divisions in India, according to Professor Amartya Sen. Lastly, before I conclude, I say that billions of people are going online to stay in touch during the COVID-19 pandemic. So we now know that billions of people are taking to online devices for their education, for their technology upgradation, etc., during this pandemic. But we have to remember that almost half of the world's population has no access to the internet, and that is why the digital divide exists. Fewer than one in five people in the least developed countries are connected. In the least developed countries, the people who have connection to the internet are less than one in five. That means if we take five people, even out of those five, maybe it is less than one who has internet connection. This digital divide is impacting women much more than men. That is also one important fact, that women are much more affected by the digital divide because women have far less access to the internet and other resources than men, than boys. So from schools, colleges, universities, setting coursework online to office staff working from home, the internet is the answer to many coronavirus lockdown problem, coronavirus lockdown. So government is saying, you don't come to office, you work from online. But what about the billions of people who can't get online? If there is no facility to go online, we cannot get education, we cannot work from home, etc. So many facilities are taken away from us if we are not, if we do not have access to internet. So globally, you have to remember that only just over half of the households, it is roughly 55%, have an internet connection. And this is the UNESCO statistic. It says, it means that more than 45% of the households do not have internet connection. And that's why the digital divide is widening. In the developed world, 87% are connected. For example, say in countries like USA or the countries in Europe, maybe it is 87% or more are connected to the internet. In the developing nations like us in India, 47% on the average are connected to internet. And in the less developed countries, like the countries in Africa, just 19%, less than 20% are connected to the internet. So in total, out of the world population, 3.7 billion people do not have internet access. So this defines the great digital divide and which has become exacerbated, so which has become enlarged or multiplied several times by the presence of the COVID pandemic. I like to conclude here, but before I conclude, I must thank the Department of Economics, the Moriah College and the IQAC for giving me this opportunity to inaugurate this webinar. And I also declare this webinar to be open. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to request the head of the Department of Economics, Dr. Meenakshi Bayon Boraman, to introduce today's resource person, Dr. Hemanta Barman, sir. May offer to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Lakshminath. Am I audible, Lakshmi?
Yes, ma'am. You are audible, ma'am.
A very warm good morning to our respected president of the Dimuria College Governing Body, Professor Krishna Gopal Bhattacharya, respected principal of Dimuria College, Dr. Biman Kumar Bhattacharya, and today's respected research person, Dr. Hemanta Barman sir of the Department of Economics, Cotton University, and to all the participants who have joined us today. Today, we have all joined in this online session to discuss on the topic, social and economic implications of digital divide, organized by the PG Department of Economics in collaboration with IQAC Dimuria College Khetri. We now live in a digital world. With the onset of the pandemic, our lives now revolve around our laptops, mobiles, and other electronic devices. We can say that it has now become a new normal for us. But this has also impacted our social and economic lives. People who do not have the means to procure such devices are often left behind, leading to more inequalities in the society. Thus, the digital divide is the gap between those who adapt themselves to the new digital age and those who do not. So, in order to learn more about the social and economic implications of this, we are today joined by Dr. Hemanta Barman sir of Cotton University, who will deliberate more on this topic. Dr. Hemanta Barman, sir, is currently working as an assistant professor in the Department of Economics, Cotton University. He has received his PhD in economics from the Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati. His primary research focus is on macroeconomic issues related to India. In his doctoral dissertation, he studied the growth and dynamics of the services industries in India with a special focus in the banking and telecommunications services. Dr. Barman has also published research articles in many reputed national as well as international journals. Before joining Cotton University, he was working as faculty at the Indian Institute of Bank Management, Guwahati. He has also worked as visiting faculty at the Indian Institute of Information Technology, Bhagalpur. We are grateful to Dr. Barman, who has accepted our invitation and decided to grace today's session. I believe all of us will be greatly benefited from his words. With these few words, I would like to conclude my speech and ask Dr. Lakshminath to carry on the further proceedings of the webinar. Thank you. Over to you, Dr. Lakshmi.
Thank you so much, ma'am. One thing I would like to mention here, that if the participants wants to ask any question regarding today's discussion topic, so they can write their questions in the chat box. During the session, the questions will be discussed in the question answer session. So now we have come to the center of today's program, that is speech of our resource person. So I would like to request Dr. Hemanta Barman, sir, to deliver his presentation. Sir, over to you.
Okay, thank you. thank you. I'm audible, I believe.
Sir, your voice is not clear, sir.
My voice is not clear, so what can I do? I stopped my video. So now, is it audible?
Sir.
Still it is not clear, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Your voice is not clear.
Is there any improvement?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
There is an improvement, right?
Yes, sir. You are audible now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. First of all, the principal, respected principal of De Moria College, Dr. P. Bhattacharya sir, then the president of the governing body, Professor K.G. Bhattacharya sir, the HOD, and the IQSC of the De Moria College, and all the respected faculty members. I'm thankful to you for giving me this opportunity to speak on a topic which means I have been or I am involved in a discussion since my PhD work. So it's a great opportunity to speak before you. And I would definitely kind of benefited also. I'll get benefit also from the speech because I would also able to learn, or I believe that I'll be able to learn from your comments and suggestions. Already Professor KZB sir has already talked about various dimensions of the digital divide, their socioeconomic implications. So I would focus on that topic only. Already sir has throws light to many aspects, but my topic that is given to me for discussion is the social and economic implications of the digital divide. I would rather focus on the term digital divide more. So if you see about the topic, if you look at the topic socioeconomic implications of the digital divide, there are three, four kind of aspects that is prominent from the topic itself. The first one is that socioeconomic implications. So what would be the implications of digital divide on the society, on the economics, on the economy of a country, on the economy of a society. The second thing is that this digital divide, the dimension, the topic digital divide itself is a very broad. So
we have to there are several definitions how digital divides are estimated or how digital divides are measured. So for example, the previous in one of the previous speech, Sir Bhattacharya sir has explained that what digital divide is. In fact, our actually madam has also talked about that, who have access and who do not have access to the technological services, particularly in the information and communication technology, is called the digital divide. So you see that when we talk about socioeconomic implications of digital divide, the first one is that we have to a little bit elaborate on what digital divide is. The second thing is that socioeconomic implications of digital divide. And the third thing is that what kind of aspect we are talking about. Are we talking about digital divide across countries? Are we talking about digital divide within India? Or are we talking about digital divide within different genders in our Assam or in a particular district or region? So there are several dimensions on the same topic. So let us start with the first thing that I would like to start with. So digital divide is a topic that is associated with information and communication technology. We all know already, it has been mentioned that the information and communication technology is the areas that we kind of relate the term digital divide or digital gap. Sometimes it is also known as digital gap. So what is information and communication technology? So information and communication technology, it's nothing but it's a technological way to process information and communication, process information and communication by electronic means. So it includes, the ICT includes a whole range of communication technologies and information processing medias. It includes radio, it includes television, it includes telephone, fax, telegram, which are kind of old ICTs. These are the information and communication technology which are old. And we all had this kind of technology, and nowadays you see that radio has already kind of in an extinct phase. In radio, it's very difficult to find nowadays radio. Television is almost available every household in our country. Then the telephone, think about the kind of older telephones that is now also become obsolete. Then the fax and telegram, these are all old kind of ICTs. The new ICTs are the internet, the wired and wireless network, then cell phones and computers. These are the group of new ICTs which are presently transforming, or presently have transformed our way of communication, our way of living. So again, now why it is important to talk about the social and economic implications of digital divide. So briefly, I will speak on some of the very common or some of the very widely studied theories of economics. The first thing is that you know that we have already in every semester we teach the Solow's growth model. The what Solow's growth model talks about, that the technological progress is the catalyst or impetus to an economy to grow faster. In the previous development theories or previous growth theories, there was no kind of technological progress. The only thing that you need, the saving GDP ratio and the marginal productivity of capital, that would actually decide what is the amount of growth that one country will achieve. But Solow has transformed that. No, this is not the case. That the technological progress is important, and with the help of technological progress, a country can exponentially grow or can improve, at least can improve the amount of growth. And we have witnessed that many small countries like Japan and other countries is fastest growing. Their growth rates are not growth rate, but their development is far penetrating than India. Why? Because of their technological progress. The second theory, important theory of technological progress, is the endogenous growth model, which is put forwarded by Robert Lucas and Paul Romer, who talks about that technological progress through human development. Actually, what Robert Solow said, that the new that technological progress is vital for economic development, but they did not talk about anything from where the technological progress will come. But the new endogenous growth model talks about the technological progress will be through human capital or through human development. The third theory that is important to understand this technological progress part is the Joseph Schumpeter's theory. So what Joseph Schumpeter talked about, that the theory says that the whole process of development is based on three premises. One is investment, the second is innovation, and third one is replacement. So a capitalist will invest then to exploit some innovation. And once the innovation is there, so he can actually have a monopoly power for some point of time. For those who are not aware of monopoly, is kind of that I assume that there are participants who are not from economics background. So monopoly means he actually is the sole producer or sole seller of a particular product. So in a way, or in an ambition, or in an expectation that he would sell some amount of his product in a monopoly way. So a producer will initially investment, take some kind of innovation or new invention, and it would replace the old existing technology or old existing product, which will give a room for the producer to have or to get some amount of profit. Which is very popularly known in economics is the process of creative destruction. So in a process that new innovations comes in, the old technologies are get away. So in that way, this is the process of creative destruction. So in all these three theories, you see that there are lots of theories who talks about technological progress, but I have brought into very popular, very common three theories here. So you see that in every theory, the technological progress becomes vital or is the kind of main crux of economic development. So if you talk about the technological progress, from where the technological progress will come, it will come from research. It will come from new innovation. It will come from new invention, and which will eventually bring new production and improvement in the productivity, which will pave the way for a country or a firm to grow faster. So now you see that this technological progress there are various rates of adoption and diffusion of technological progresses. So this technological progress depends upon how people adopt this new technology and how these new technologies are diffused in among the masses, among the countries. So there are many technologies that have diffused very rapidly, but there are many technologies which take some time to kind of spread across the country. And also in our case, many times we adopt some technologies, we do not adopt some technologies. Again, you see that this adoption and diffusion of new technologies will depend upon many things. First is the ability, whether we are able to adopt new technologies or not. The second thing is willingness, whether we are willing to adopt or not. The third is the stage of development. For example, see that many of us were not willing to adopt the new modes of teaching, that is a video kind of thing, previously. But when this virus came and we thought that it will go away in 1 month, but it did not, then our UGC or the universities have instructed us to take online classes. So we usually or gradually start adopting the new technology. So we were able, but we were not willing at the initial stage, but now we are willing as well. But the important thing is that the adoption and diffusion of a technology also depends on the level of development, how developed we are. Even if we are willing or able to take advantage of some new technology, it may not be possible because of the stage of our development. For example, today in my speech, I have to switch off my video because there was an internet problem and the voice was not clear enough. So when I switch off the video, then probably my voice is clear enough. So this is an example, the stage of development. So in many areas or in many cases, the stage of development is such that we may not be, or we kind of not able to kind of take advantage of new technology, even we are able and willing to adopt the new technology. Now you see that in this technological progress, ICT is one among these technologies. So ICT is very crucial in economic development as well as social development, because it allows us to access to all kinds of information. It allows us to explore all the knowledges that available in and around us. So already has we have learned that what is the figure of the amount of coronavirus infection. We already know that what is the genome sequence, what is the new variant of the virus is coming in. So how this is able, because of this ICT, this technology has enabled all of us to access all the information, all the knowledge kind of across the country, across the globe very easily. So it reduces the information asymmetry that we have. So this is the ICT, this is the power of ICT, which reduces the information asymmetry. And we are now all equipped with all information, and we can use, we can kind of explore this information to create new knowledge, create new inventions, and etc. So what does the, what, how does the ICT is making us this capable? This is because it reduces the geographical barriers. Now there is no geography. For example, for this talk, I have not met my dear friend Bipul personally. We have talked over WhatsApp, we have talked over telephone, and that's all. We are now, I'm sitting in the one part of the state. Many of us are, I have learned that many of the participants are outside Assam. They are sitting at their respective homes, but we are enjoying, or we are now together to speak or listen to a topic on digital divide. So it reduces the geographical barriers. Now you see that it also able, or it also gives us the opportunity to take the comparative advantage. For example, India is a hub of many BPO centers. Many companies, multinational companies across countries are setting up their call centers and other kind of facility centers in various parts of our country. Why? Because we have a comparative advantage of cheap skilled labor. So those countries have set up their BPO centers in India to assist their customers or their clients across the globe. So how India has kind of take advantage of their comparative advantage with the help of ICT. So this is the importance of ICT technology, or the information and communication technology, in the economic development. Now, to be very briefly, the ICT unlocks the new capabilities, or it is a new capabilities of an economy, or it becomes a catalyst to the economic growth through three basic premises. One is knowledge. The second one is efficiency. The third one is network. Now you see that.
Sir, your screen is not visible, sir.
I got to know. Let me be connected. It's visible now?
Yes, sir, it's visible now.
Okay, thank you. So what I was talking about, that there are three basic premises, or three basic areas, that is knowledge, efficiency, and networks. Knowledge, through which it diffuses the knowledge, reduces asymmetry, as we have already talked about. The efficiency, it improves efficiency or productivity. It improves efficiency and productivity in many other developmental projects, such as healthcare, education. We all know about this already. KZB sir has also mentioned this ability of the ICT to help us in many in this development projects, such as healthcare, education, etc. Then also network. It also allows us to exploit global network of people, information and knowledge. So I have, during this lockdown, I have attended many webinars of a kind of prominent economists across the globe. So what do we have to do? All the links are available in the internet. We have to just click on and just to log in the meeting. And there the famous economists, many, many, many prominent economists speaks, and we listen. So this allows the network. So this is the free premises on the basis of which, means through which ICT becomes a catalyst to the economic growth. However, there is a technological divide across countries, not only the ICTs, but across technology, there are technological divide. For example, a few countries produces most technology. Some other country able to adopt a few of these technologies. See, for example, the technological development is nowadays is concentrated. You talk about that software and other thing. India has some edge over there. You talk about defense equipment, the USA, Russia, China, and Israel. You talk about car manufacturing, automobile industry, Japan, South Korea, and all Germany, these countries, the most of the technology. You talk about the Rafale. This is the French technology, and some other European countries are also making that kind of technology. But the less developed countries are not able to actually produce or innovate this kind of technology. Yes, we do. As a country, developing country, we do adopt some of these few technology. For India, we are trying to make some defense equipment, some aircraft, some other technological advancement. But we are not kind of the front runner. So this is an example of India. But think about other countries, other African countries, other poorer countries. They even not able to adopt. Talk about the space exploration. Only a few countries are able to achieve that kind of technological achievement, including India. But think about the other countries. Now India is a front runner in space technology. So for launching satellites, India can kind of, the success rate is very high for India. But think about the other countries, their success rate is not that high. So this is the technological divide we have. Now you see that when there is a technological divide, the poorer countries has low productivity, and eventually it will lead to the low economic growth and development. But those countries which have achieved or which have higher kind of technological progress, they have higher productivity, higher economic growth and development. So now let us talk about the digital divide, the technological inequity in terms of ICT. Now you see that we all know that ICT or digital divide in terms of inequity in the information and communication technologies. We know that who have access to some ICTs and who do not have access to ICTs is known as the digital gap or digital divide. It is the uneven diffusion of technology and inequality in the access of information and communication technologies. So digital divide can exist in many ways. It can exist among rich and poor. It can exist among rural and urban. It can exist among men and women. It can exist between generations. Yes, that is true. It can exist between generations as well. It can exist between skilled and unskilled. And it can also exist between large and small enterprises. Let us talk about some examples. Again, I believe my slide has disconnected, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, let me again reconnect it. This is perhaps because of the digital divide.
Yes, sir. It is visible now.
Okay, thank you. So when let us talk about some examples. So rich and poor. So we know that the rich has the ability to purchase or ability to adopt new technology. The poor does not have. Then you see that the rich countries, you talk about the rich people, you talk about the kind of rich areas, all the kind of new technologies are available there, but in poorer countries, the technologies are not available. Similarly for rural and urban areas. You talk about Guwahati, you talk about the urban areas in our state, you talk about Mumbai, you talk about Chennai, you talk about Kolkata, you will able to find all the new technologies. But in rural areas, you will get hardly any of these rural services, any of these services. We do have a connection of 4G network, but the speed is pathetic. Then, as KZB sir has said, there is a digital divide among men and women. This is called gender disparity. So the man has kind of an advantage over digital access, whereas women does not have. Then between generations, the older generation and the newer generation, some technologies are such that it requires some sort of skills that might be the older generations are a little, I'm not saying that they're less equipped, but they're in a lag to kind of take advantage of those new technologies. Then skilled and unskilled technology, persons. So many skilled persons can have access to all the ICTs available, but unskilled persons do not have. Even if you give a good amount, a good phone or good internet connection to an unskilled person, he would not be, or he would kind of barely be benefited from that connection. So the skill and skill is also required to have access or have to have certain amount of digital access in terms of information and communication technology. The last one is that large and small enterprise. We know that the large enterprise has more digital access than the small enterprises. You see, you talk about State Bank of India. Let us take about the State Bank of India and other private sectors bank. They have all the facilities, all the technologies, but think about our bank, the small banks in Assam, say for example, Apex Cooperative Bank or any other city cooperative bank. They do not have that amount of kind of information and technology to provide all the services to its customer sitting at their home. Now State Bank of India, then other bank, other private sector bank will have all the facilities. You have internet banking, you have ATM. Even if you have any problem, you can solve it, sort it out through online. But for those kind of small enterprises, small banks, you have to go to the bank to have kind of address some sort of your our issues with the bank. So there is an also digital divide for large and small enterprise. Then the most important thing for digital divide we have to understand is that it is dynamic. It changes over time. Newer technology, more divide. So initially, or it was believed that the digital divide kind of means it would say static. Say for example, teledensity. So I will talk about teledensity a little later, but talk about any ICT. So we thought that if everyone would have an internet connection, then we are happy, or we will not say that this, there is a digital divide, but it changes over time. Think about initially we had GPRS. Now we had 2G technology. Then it transformed to 3G technology. Now it is 4G technology that we have. Now you see that the 5G technology, trial of 5G technologies is running in other countries. Now you think about that when we will receive the 5G technology, the other countries will have 6G technology. So it changes over time. So whenever there is a newer technology in the domain, so there is a more divide. You see that older technologies are more or less kind of adopted by individuals or most of the kind of most sections of the society, but the newer technology has more digital divide. It can also be multiple and overlapping. So it can be within countries, within region, between genders, so et cetera, et cetera. So we may have a good amount of digital connection across the countries, but there may be digital divide within regions. Say, for example, Assam, and say, for example, Tamil Nadu or Karnataka, which are richer states than that of us. Or say, for example, Delhi. We will have more digital divide in terms of richer states and the poorer states. Secondly, within the states, it is possible that we have digital divide within Assam. Say, for example, rural areas and urban areas. So there are many underlying factors, but one important point is that the digital divide persists with disparities in wealth. So the digital divide persists with disparities in wealth. So more wealthy state or more wealthy individual, it is likely that he can has or he will have better digital connection or better digital access to him or a state. You think about all the states, for example, in our country as well, the richer states has more digital access than the poorer states. In Assam itself, Guwahati has more digital access than any other areas of Assam, because it believes that it is because of the wealth, because of the resources. Now you see next, we have much talk about the digital divide or digital gap, but how much the digital gap or digital divide? This is a picture which gives you the mobile cellular subscription in percentage of some countries, Brazil, China, India, and United States, and in internet user in percentage is Brazil, China, India, and United States. The selection of the year is based on availability, and these are random selection. And the countries are also random selections, but the selections are random, but we have selected some countries, say for example, Brazil, China, and India are the emerging economies. They are kind of fastest growing economies as well. United States, we all know it's a developed country. So you see that where India stands, at least in terms of internet users. So mobile cellular subscription, we can consider it's a kind of, or a little bit older technology. The internet is a kind of recent technology. So you see the digital divide. Less than or slightly above 30% of our population has internet access, whereas it is more than 80% in the United States, more than 50% in China, and more than 60% in Brazil. Whereas in India, it is only 30%. Think about out of only 100, only 30 has internet access in our country. Of course, in terms of mobile cellular subscription, we have more than 80%. And some other countries have above 100%, say for example, China and USA. So you might ask that if it is in percentage terms, so how can it be more than 100% or more than 100 or it is 120? It is perhaps because of the two connections, because we have, many of us have two connections. So in that way, it might lead to the, more than 100, even if we have estimated it in terms of percentage. Now, it is the active mobile broadband subscriber in per 100 inhabitants. See, the again picture, India is far below than the other countries. China, Brazil, United States, India has far below active mobile broadband subscriber, broadband subscriber per 100 inhabitants, less than 50. Even 50 of us do not have access to internet, this broadband internet connection in India in comparison to the other three countries. Now you see that the individuals using internet by gender. So you see that again, the years I have marked it in red, because this is the latest available data. That is for Brazil, it is available for 2019. For China, it is available for 2020. And for India, it is available for 2018. See that overall, only 20% of us is using internet, out of which the male is 25 and the female is 14%. However, you can see that Brazil and China, the percentage of male and female is almost similar, but India, there has been a digital divide or digital gap between male and female. Now, these are the various dimensions. You can talk about mobile telephone access. You can talk about, say, for example, internet. You can talk about mobile subscription. You can talk about how much people we have internet connectivity. But the International Telecommunication Union, which is a specialized agency of United Nations for ICTs, it is a specialized institutions for ICTs. It is responsible for many of the ICT related activities across the globe. So they have developed a comprehensive measure called ICT Development Index, shortly known as IDI. So it has three dimensions. One, ICT access. It captures the readiness or infrastructure, whether a country or a state is available or is ready to have a particular amount of, or having the infrastructure to adopt certain ICTs. Then ICT use, which captures the ICT intensity in the society. So how we use the ICT. So this is the second indicators, the second dimensions of the comprehensive measure, that is the IDI. The third indicator is the ICT skill, which captures the capability or skills that are important to use ICT. So these three, you see that what IT, International Telecommunication Union, ITU has derived, it has developed a comprehensive measure of the digital divide, which is known as ICT Development Index or IDI. It has three dimensions. One is ICT access, which measures or captures the infrastructure available. Second, the ICT use, that is the intensity of use of ICT of the society or in the society. Then ICT skill, that is the capability, whether we are able to or we are kind of able to adopt those ICTs, information and communication technology or not. So ICT development index is a composite index of these three dimensions: ICT access, ICT use, and ICT skill. So let me go to directly to the next slide. So this slide shows you the how the International Telecommunication Union has constructed the IDI. So it has 5 indicators for ICT access, which are fixed telephone subscriptions, mobile cellular telephone subscription, international internet bandwidth per internet user, then household with a computer, and household with internet access. All have 20% weightage each. So how the ICT access indicator is ICT access index is calculated. Then the ICT use. It has 3 indicators. The first one is the percentage of individuals using internet, fixed broadband subscription per 100 inhabitants. And the third one is the active mobile broadband subscription per 100 inhabitants. All have 33% weightage. So thus, the second sub-index, that is the ICT use, is constructed. And the third is that the skill. How we measure the skill? We measure the skill as mean years of schooling, secondary gross enrollment ratio. And the third is the tertiary gross enrollment ratio. So thus we obtain the ICT scale by giving 33% weightage to each of these 3 indicators. Now, finally, from these 3 sub-indexes, ICT access, ICT use, and ICT skill, we construct the IDI, that is ICT development index, by giving 40% weightage to ICT access and ICT use, and the remaining 20% weightage to ICT skill. So finally, the ICT development index, or IDI, is ranges from 1, which is indicates the worst, and 10, which indicates the best development in terms of ICT. So you see that I have listed some countries, including India, the value of IDI, and the rank among the countries. So the International Telecommunication Union has publishes the IDI across countries annually. This is the 2017 figure. So you see that India with 3.03 is ranked, 3.03 IDI value is ranked 134th among the 176th countries. The first country is the Iceland. The second, the USA is in the 16th position. The Brazil is in the 66th position. China is in the 80th position. And of course, many a times we like to compare us with Pakistan. And that's why I have put Pakistan as well. And Pakistan's position is 148. Of course, the only kind of, for example, good news for us that Pakistan is below us. But as a whole, the position of development in the information and communication technology as per 2017 is not satisfactory or not good in India. However, there is an important point, is that the ITU, the International Telecommunication Union, is revising the construction of the IDI with inclusion and exclusion of some indicators. So after 2017, IDI revising, or IDI kind of in a debate to revise their IDI construction with exclusion of some rest relevant indicators. Well, they think that they would include some relevant indicators. So what are these? So in the ICT access, they exclude fixed telephone subscription, mobile cellular subscription. In terms, they have include percentage of population covered by mobile network, at least with 3G and LTE, then fixed broadband subscription, weighted by speed per 100 population. So nowadays, it is not that you have an internet connection. You should have at least 3G connection. Nowadays, it is not sufficient to have a broadband subscription. You should have a good amount of speed as well. Then in ICT use, they have excluded fixed broadband subscription per 100 population, and they include mobile broadband internet traffic per mobile broadband subscription. In the ICT skill, there is no change. So again, it is important to note that there has been a debate over this construction of new IDI or revised IDI. But till that, the ITU has not published the new IDI. That's why we have to rely on the data of 2017. hopefully that in 2021 the new IDI will be released, and that after release we can actually compare with the new construction. Now we talked about the digital divide, ICT, about the globe, across the world. Now what is the progress in India? So in India, the progress is very impressive. You see that in terms of teledensity, we have now more than 86% teledensity. That means we have out of 186, more than 86% have a telephone connection. In rural areas, it is 59, and in urban areas, it is 139. So you see that there is a kind of digital divide exists in the rural and urban areas in India, whereas in urban areas, almost everyone is having, means 100% is having a telephone connection, some also having a dual kind of connection, whereas in rural areas, you have only 60%, roughly 60% of connection, still 40% does not have a phone connection. So many studies have published over the year, that is Sridhar, Ghoshan Prasad, even in our publication in 2018, what we have found that there is an uneven growth of the telecommunication services in our country across states, and there exists a digital divide. However, this is important to note that this is despite uniform policy framework across states. So the policies of telecommunication services is similar across states, but some states have kind of grown faster, their teledensity is much higher. Some states are lagging behind. So let us talk about the ICT progress in India in a chronology, the policy, what the policies are in India. So in 1980s, actually, it has all started. So for example, in 1980s, the telecommunication services was very poor. It is about 0.3 teledensity. That means less than one in 100 did not have a telephone connection in 1981. There was a famous joke at that time that half of the time you could not get a dial tone, and the other half, if you can get a dial tone, you will get a wrong number at that time in 1980-81. Even there is a famous story that is mentioned in the book by the emerging India, the emerging giant by Arvind Panagariya. He has said that, he has written that in parliament, one of the member of parliament has complained about the broken down telephone connection of his office, that if his telephone can be broken down or means takes months to fix, what would be the status of the other common people? Then the minister of telecommunication of that time has reported that there is a 8 years long waiting period. And if someone wants to surrender that broken down product, means they can. So that is the scenario of the telecommunication services in that time. So in 1995, government has established or initiated this Department of Telecommunication. So in the Department of Telecommunication, there is an MTNL, that is Mahanagar Telephone Nigam Limited, which will provide telephone services to Delhi and Bombay. The DOT, that is Department of Telecommunication, will provide services to rest of the country, and VSNL for international services. So this is the progress in 1985. In 1990, the first bidding for private sector was initiated, but the bidding process, entire bidding process for the telecommunication services for the private sector was messy and very long. Actually, the main purpose of DOT was to retard entry of the private sector. At that time, it was a phase of economic liberalization. So there was a kind of economic debate that one section wanted economic reform, one section, the other section did not want. So at the time, DOT actually used all its powers to retard entry of private sector in telecommunication process or telecommunication services in India. That's why they made the bidding process too messy and too long, so that the private sector or private player cannot enter. So to have this issue sorted out, in 1997, the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India was established. The objective of the authority, Telecom Regulatory, was to resolve disputes and set tariff. resolve disputes among whom? To resolve disputes among DOT, that is the Department of Telecommunication, and the other private players who actually trying to enter into the Indian telecommunication services. So DOT is still the licensing agency of the telecommunication services in India. In 2000, the DOT has been separated into two separate entities. One is Department of Telecommunication and other one is the Department of Telecom Services, which is later known as BSNL. So what is the main objective of this separation? So Government of India wanted that the licensing process and the service provider should be separate to have a rapid growth or to have an expansion in the telecom services in India. Because since initially the licensing, the DOT was the licensing authority as well as a telephone service provider. So it actually uses all its powers to enjoy monopoly over the telecom services and restricted private entity from entering into the telecommunication services. Only after this separation, the government allowed unlimited competition in the telecom services and the entry of Bharti and Reliance become possible in 2000. In summary, what we understood from this chronology is that the economic reform brought some structural changes in the Indian telecom sector and it abolishes the monopoly of the Department of Telecommunications, and which in turn helped rapid growth of telecommunication. So anyone who is interested in reading or in having more details of these chronology of the growth of the telecommunication sector, one can read the book, The India, the Emerging Giant by Arvind Panagaria. So after that, you see that there are several telecommunication policies in India as well, which are there. So the first telecommunication policy in India was 1994, NTP, that is the National Telecommunication Policy 1994. So at that time, the kind of India's tele-density was far low from all other neighboring countries, such as China, Pakistan, Malaysia, etc. So in that policy of telecommunication, the government of India set some physical targets. For example, telecommunication services to all villages by 1997. At least one public call office or PCO that we used to know about for every 500 person in 1997 and in urban areas, etc. So these are the physical targets that was placed in the National Telecommunication Policy in 1994. However, there has been a massive failure and these targets could not be attained during that period. In 1999, another telecommunication policy known as New Telecom Policy has been announced. So there are also some physical targets is that increase the tele density of 7 by the year 2005 and 15 by 2010. It allowed FDI up to 49% through automatic route. It further, in a sense, it further liberalized the telecom sector in India. Another telecommunication policy in 2012 that was announced. So again, some physical targets, these were increased the rural tele density to 70 by 2017 and 100 by 2020, affordable and reliable broadband connection to all on demand by 2015, provide high speed and high quality broadband access to all village panchayats by 2014, and broadband access to all villages and habitations by 2020. So these are the physical targets of the national telecom policies. Some of the targets are achieved more or less. Some of the targets are yet to be achieved. For example, broadband connection to all the villages are yet to be achieved. The panchayats are not, all the panchayats are not yet connected. So another telecommunication policy known as the National Digital Communication Policy in 2018 was announced. So again, there are some targets, provisioning of broadband for all, then propelling India to top 50 nations in the ICT Development Index of ITU from 134. As we have just studied that the ICT development, in the ICT Development Index, India's position is 134. So the government aims to bring India within the top 50 of the ranking for the National Digital Communication Policies. Now, let us talk about a few things of the digital divide in India. You see, in this slide, I have put the state with highest and lowest tele density from 2030 to 2021. You see where Bihar stands, that is the lowest tele density in our country, and where the highest tele density for some period up to 2015, Tamil Nadu was the highest state with the highest tele density, whereas in the later half, that is from 16 to 21, Himachal Pradesh is the highest state with the highest tele density. So you see the digital gap where Bihar stands and where Himachal Pradesh stands. So this is the digital gap in terms of tele density, right? So this tele density shows you the overall and overall rural and urban. You see that the rural tele density is the blue bars, then urban tele density is the saffron bars, and the overall tele density is shown the black line. So you see the how the gap is there between rural and urban tele density in India, and that is persistent since say 2005 or 6. Still, we do not have 60% of rural tele density, whereas urban tele density has gone up to more than 160%. So this is the amount of digital divide that we have at present in our country. Now, another way to measure the digital divide or examining digital divide is the relative tele density. This is a very easy measure. So what we can do, we can just have the tele density of state I in the time period T minus the national average of that time period. So this is the relative tele density. So if you have a positive relative tele density, you can say that that particular state is above the national average at that particular time. And if relative tele density is negative, that means that particular state have lower tele density than the national average. So you can see that in this figure, I have plotted for all the states. Okay, so if the bar is above zero, that means it is it has a higher national average, means tele density than higher national, the higher than the national average. If the bar is below the zero line, that means the state in that particular year has a lower tele density than the national average. You can easily find out which are the states which have lower tele density. You see the Assam, you see Bihar, you see Orissa, you see West Bengal, you see Madhya Pradesh. These are the four states which have lower tele density than the national average. However, you can see that some of the states like Himachal Pradesh, Gujarat, then Tamil Nadu, then Punjab, these are comparatively richer states than the states that I have already mentioned. So their tele density is higher than the national average. Now, this is for the urban areas, and you can see that except Himachal Pradesh. Himachal Pradesh is a kind of peculiar case. All the states have, the bars are kind of around zero. That means all the states more or less have tele density, urban tele density close to the national average. Only Punjab has some higher, Kerala has some higher tele density, and Himachal Pradesh. The rest of the states have kind of tele density of similar kind of to the with the national average. So this is for the rural areas. You can see again the Assam has all the negative bars, Bihar has all the negative bars, then West Bengal have negative bars in the latter half, then other states are kind of above the national average. So this figure also shows that Assam, Bihar, and some Madhya Pradesh, these are the countries which are, these are the states which have a lower average tele density than that of the national rural tele density. So these are the states that have to kind of improve its tele density to have or to reduce the digital gap. Now, when we talk about the digital divide in terms of telephone, there the next things comes about the internet. So in internet also, India has achieved a lot. India has overall 55.41% overall internet subscriber. urban areas, it is about 98.38%, and it is about 33.00% in rural areas. So this figure shows you the digital divide in internet subscription per 100 population. So you see that the blue line is the the green bar is the urban figure, that is the internet subscriber per 100 population. The orange line is the rural internet subscriber. You see the digital divide between the green bar and the orange bar. The red line indicates the India total, means overall average for the India, for the country. The blue line, that is the dashed line, the blue dashed line shows the India average for all India average for the rural areas, and the green dashed line shows the all India average for the urban areas. If you are finding it a little bit clumsy, see the figures for Assam. You see that India's orange line is not touching the India's rural blue line. That means the overall rural internet subscription is lower in Assam than the national average. You can see that the Indian urban is the green dashed line. And for Assam, the bar of the green bar has above the national average. That means in urban areas, the internet subscriber is more than that of national average. But if you talk about some other countries, for example, say, let us take about Kerala. In Kerala, you see that the rural internet subscriber is higher than the urban internet subscriber. So this is picture gives you the kind of overall idea about where the states stand in terms of internet subscription per 100 population. So in rural areas, most of the states have need to improve its average, including Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, Haryana, these countries have rural internet subscription just above the national average. But some other countries like West Bengal, Madhya Pradesh, Assam, Bihar, these are the states which have lower rural rural internet subscription than the national average. So again, these are the poorer states in comparison to the other states. So now, what in the conclusion, I would like to comment that the government of India is making constant efforts to improve the telecommunications. That is through national telecommunication policy, the new telecom policy in 1990, and then again the telecommunication policy of 2012, and then again the national digital communication policy in 2018. So there has been a considerable expansion of tele density and subscription over the years, but the kind of expansion across the state is not even. The expansion is uneven. So significant digital gap still prevails. However, there is an important thing to note that what I have already said, that initially, even we in our paper in 2018, when we have published it, we thought that the digital gap can be narrowed and digital gap can be kind of, there is a convergence that all the countries will ultimately reach to the national average, and there will be a reduction in the digital gap. But this is not the case, because digital gap is dynamic in nature and dynamic in technology. So all the time there is a new technology, there is a digital gap. So in our case also, if the 5G technology someday is kind of in the next year, say for example, 5G technology is rolled out in India, which are the place which will first get the first 5G technology? Of course, it is Mumbai, it's Delhi, it's Kolkata and Chennai. We will not get the first 5G technology. Then perhaps if 5G technologies are rolled out in Assam, It will be perhaps firstly Guwahati, Jorhat, Dibrugarh, or the Kokrajhar and these places. After 1 or 2 years only, we will get 5G technologies, I believe. So there will be a continuous kind of gap. And there is a kind of very hard possibilities that, yes, in numbers we can achieve or we can converse with the national average, but in terms of access or in terms of real kind of access, it is difficult to have that kind of convergence. Then again, you see the rapid innovation and replacement is another way which actually persists or which actually makes the digital divide in a continuous process. So you see that there has been a continuous innovation and continuous replacement of old technology. You see what we used, the telephones or phones that we have used 2 or 3 years back. Now the telephones are or the smartphones are more equipped with kind of a new processor, a high speed kind of transmission, higher memories and all the things. Nowadays, all of us, at least not all, if not some of us prefers to iPhone because of their technology, because of their services, rather than say, for example, some low cost mobile or low cost smartphones. So this rapid innovation and replacement of new technology has also made it difficult to kind of the accelerate the convergence of digital gap. Then we know that what Schumpeter has talked about, this is the creative destruction. So in creative destruction, perhaps it will continue because there is a kind of say new technology will come up, the older technology will go away. So this will continue. You see, means again, we can take example of ourselves that initially what we had GPRS, then we adopted 2G, then we adopted 3G. Now we have adopted 4G. In some areas, the 4G technologies, in most of the areas, they provide 4G services, but we do not get 4G services. We get a much lesser kind of Mbps, which is known as the bandwidth, that is the speed, not speed actually, that is the amount of data that is transmitted per unit of time. So you see that there has been always a process of creative destruction, which has again, makes the digital divide a continuous process or a dynamic process. What I believe is that there should be government intervention and to ensure standard ICT service. So we cannot keep pace with the private entities. We cannot keep pace with we cannot rely on private entities to set up all this or to provide services to all the areas simultaneously to narrow the digital gap. That's why the government intervention is must. And perhaps because of that, in NTP 2012 and National Digital Telecommunication Policy 2018, the government has have set some physical targets of establishing say for example broadband connections to every villages, to every individuals on demand. So these kind of policies have government has already initiated, but of course there is a kind of long way to achieve that digital connection across the length and breadth of our country, at least in Assam. But we can only expect that the digital divide will narrow up, and at least we will be able to get or adopt a standard or efficient amount of ICT services, which will make our life or makes our, say, for example, life easy with the professions that we have. Because nowadays, at least with the case of coronavirus, ICT has become, say, indispensable in our daily life. And that is the end of my speech. And I again thank you for this opportunity to speak or talk about the digital divide and its socio-economic implications. And thank you, sir. And thank you to talk before all of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. You have given an excellent presentation. Your presentation is very much informative. So we can learn many things from your presentation. So here, one thing I would like to mention here, that the feedback form link will be posted in the chat box during the last part of the question answer session. So all the participants are requested to fill up the feedback form to get their certificates. So our next agenda is question answer session. So sir, we have got some questions from our participants. So sir, if you feel comfortable, so you can answer the questions. So sir, will you want to continue or you need a break?
Okay, so for a question answer, so let I can take actually, I can take. So there are, I can see a lot of comment about very nice. Okay. The figures of digital divide also,
yes,
it is pandemic will work as gap reducer as the demand for online service increase day by day. So I don't know, it is a, I think from Sampurna, that the figures of the digital divide and also India's position, is this pandemic will work as a gap reducer as a demand for online service increase day by day. So I don't think that it would be the pandemic will work as a gap reducer, because as we all know that the economy of all the countries, not in India, has disrupted in several way. So in that way, many have to surrender their phones, their connections, and cannot do recharge. So all the economic activities has down, people's income has gone down. So in a way, it will actually grow the digital divide. For example, in our locality, we can see many people are not able to have enough to do their research. As a faculty, we also understand, we have encountered this problem many a time. So many students of us also have this problem about their connectivity, their research, and any most of the things. So I don't think that the pandemic will reduce the gap. Yes, of course, the pandemic has forced many of us to adopt who were not willing to adopt the new technology, but the gap perhaps will kind of expand. Then the next, Simi Sharma, sir, North Eastern state is specific also lagging behind in technology. What should states do to improve themselves apart from relying on the national service? Is the problem economic isolation or continuing poor ICT development and creating a regional digital divide? Is the prolonged economic isolation is contributing to its poor ICT development? Is as a state, we cannot do much. Yes, it is totally not correct statement. As a state, what we can do, see, once there is an industrial kind of, say, activities, see, how the bank, the Karnataka has improved their tele-density. You see that all the rich states have higher tele-density, higher internet connectivity in India. Barring some countries like Bihar, Assam, which are poor states, Madhya Pradesh. So one thing we can discuss about that, if there is a better industrial activity, better income, people can afford newer technology, then of course the private parties, private players will come and provide telecom services across the states. Now you see that in Guwahati, you can have all the available resources, all the available services. You have Jio fiber, you have Airtel fiber, you have all the facilities, all the services in Guwahati, but in rural areas, you will not find all the facilities. Sometimes somewhere you will get Airtel, somewhere you will get Reliance. Forget about Jio fiber, forget about Airtel fiber connection. So one thing is that if there is a kind of rise in economic activities, then of course, I believe that the private player always looks at the opportunities. What is the market opportunities for them? If there is a market potentials, market opportunities, definitely they will set up all the technologies, all the facilities. But until then, the government has to kind of intervene to have, to provide at least some standard, say, internet services or ICT services. Then the second question she has is that is the prolonged economic isolation contributing to the poor ICT development and creating the regional divide? Of course, the prolonged isolation means you cannot, we would not say isolation, but prolonged economic underdevelopment, we can say that prolonged economic underdevelopment has contributed to the poor development in the ICT. If we had better infrastructure, better industrial facilities, better income. In fact, what we did in our studies, we studied the impact of the per capita income of a state to its tele-density. We found that there is a positive relationship. So, of course, if we are rich, if we are wealthy as a state, not as a person, then of course the ICT would improve. Then will the digital development be being economic development, especially in the Northeast? Of course, digital development has all the potentials, all the kind of you can look at. If you type in Google that importance of digital development in economy, you will find lots of connection, lots of causality, lots of interlinks between digital development and economic development. You see, we have another paper on telecommunications or tele-density, ICT and international tourist arrivals. So we have seen that when there is a good amount of internet, so you can post a photo, you can have a, nowadays you see that most of the YouTubers have travel blog, most of the YouTubers, whatever means there are lots of YouTube content nowadays. So if we can present our state in a way, that it can be accessed by across the regions, across the country. So that is a kind of advertisement. That would be a kind of advertisement. If we have a good blog on Kaziranga, if we have a good blog on the places that we can visit in Assam. So in that way, we can bring economic development. And also, see, for example, in other areas also, if you use digital technology and can work more efficiently, then it's better for our development. Think about some years back when, let us talk about the banking or let us talk about the means other sector. In banking, if there is a good amount of digital connections, there will be less often disruption in the network. There is the no link kind of piece. But if you have a good, if you do not have a good internet connection, there will be lots of time, lots of wastage. In medical sector also, there is a kind of, now there is a network of people, network of doctors. By sitting at Guwahati, you can communicate to doctors, in Mumbai or even in outside the country. So there is a lot of connections, lot of dimensions, lot of causality how digital development can bring development to a region, specifically in the Northeast. So another question is given by development is the only way to become a developed country, because in India there is a question is digital development the only way to become a developed country? Because in India there are lots of problems like poverty, unemployment, literacy, malnutrition, health related issues. See, digital development cannot be the only way to become a developed country. Digital development is a way to tackle various developmental issues. So digital development, we can tackle poverty. So digital development, we can tackle unemployment. For digital development, we can tackle literacy. For digital development, we can tackle malnutrition. For digital development, we can tackle health-related issues. Say, for example, I'm talking about only health-related issues. Now you know about the ASHA workers who collects the details of, women from a area. So nowadays, you see that what the ASHA worker will do, he will or she will collect the information, put in a digital device. It will be automatically get reflected to some server. there from the government will make policies that, okay, this is needed, that policy intervention is needed. So you can think about, you will find the help or contribution of the digital development in all aspects of economic development. So digital development is not the only way, but of course it is an indispensable way to have a developed country. So I hope that is sufficient.
Okay, sir. Sir, thank you, sir, for your active participation, also to the participants for your active participation in the question answer session. So now we can say the question answer session is over. So one thing I would like to mention here, the email ID of today's resource person, Dr. Hemanta Verma sir, will be shared in the chat box. If the participants have any questions, they can send their questions at his email ID. So moving to our next agenda, I would like to request the coordinator IQAC, Dimore College, Dr. Manav Borkakoti sir, to say some few lines regarding today's program and also to express a vote of thanks on behalf of the entire organizing committee. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Lakshmi, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. Firstly, I would like to welcome our honorable guest, Dr. Hemanta Verma, Assistant Professor, Department of Economics, Cotton University, on behalf of IQAC of our college, for his very nicely illustrated lecture on the topic, Social and Economic Implication of Digital Divide. I am very grateful to SAR for accepting our invitation as a resource person in this webinar. As the moderator requested me to give the vote of thanks also, so I would like to thank on behalf of our college and IQAC team. First of all, I want to thank our governing body president, Professor K.G. Bhatto sir, for his consent to present in the webinar and deliver welcome address. I sincerely thank our principal sir for his consent and following us to allowing us to conduct the webinar. He is our source of inspiration for our all academic activities. I sincerely thank and heartiest thanks to Dr. Hemanta Verma for valuable lecture on the topic, without which we could not have conducted this webinar. Even though the topic is of economics, sir made us the people who doesn't have the same background understandable each and every aspect of it. I am pretty sure that our student and all the family members, all the faculty members were benefited from your lecture. Our special thanks goes to all the participants and the faculty members and students of different colleges and our colleges, without whom our webinar could not have been a successful one. I extended my vote of thanks and congratulate the PG department, especially HOD Dr. Meenakshi and her team for their united efforts to make it a success. Last but certainly not the least, I gave my heartiest thanks on behalf of IQAC team to all the people who helped us directly or indirectly to make this event successful. Thank you very much. Now I would like to hand over the event to Dr. Lakshmi.
Thank you so much, sir. So we have come to the end of today's session. I again thank you all for giving your valuable time with us. Hereby, I formally declare the end of today's program. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lucky congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.